Hi, my name is Valentine, and this is my first app and my journey to Go. This is the first code project I've actually shipped, so. And then Audrey approached me and asked me to see whether I wanted to give a talk about it, so I just thought, you know, why not? So hopefully I can get some feedback or something. So before Go, I played around with HTML, CSS, basic JavaScript, and a lot of WordPress. So, and also a bit of Ruby. But I think Go is probably the deepest I've ever delved into a language and actually built a project and completed something and shipped something and uploaded it on GitHub. So this is what happened when I actually ran Go install for the first time. It's like, oh my god, I compiled a binary that I can run instead of, you know, some script that I can view the text of. Now I have something that, well, it's a proper program. Just why I chose to learn Go was partly because I was reading about languages and I chanced upon this one. So basically, there's only 25 keywords in Go, and the whole of the standard library is basically comprised of like code that uses these keywords. And it seems fairly easy, and it seems that it's very, it's very like grounds up, so you can just use these words and build like whatever you want. And the standard library, like from what I've heard, is excellent. There's a lot of things that people have already done many, many times, and they thought it was a good idea to put into the standard library. And so they cut out all the, I don't know what you call it, boilerplate. So you just call out the standard library and you get to do like a lot of magical stuff. So this is one of the books I use. It's probably the most basic thing ever, but it shows a lot about Go in general. You know, your types, your variables, your control structures, and all the different the core package. One thing I did find though was that there's so many resources about Go, but I think a lot of them don't really talk about the standard library much. So when I wanted to use like the image library, as I'll show you later, it turned out to be a lot of guesswork. You know, you just input values in and you just hope something comes out. This was also really helpful. This is the Slack community for Gophers. So basically you see a lot of like Go talk inside. So I basically just go there and just look and do basically nothing at all. But it's good. I mean, like they're also really helpful. Like if you want to ask questions, if you ask them nicely, they would usually be very nice and reply to you. What I did was I took part in the Go challenge, like what Audrey mentioned just now. So the challenge for last one was the mosaic creator, which basically means you take a photo and a bunch of photos and you make the photo look like another photo. I'll show you later. But there's a bunch of other requirements, and the challenge was actually much harder. But I mean, I thought that it was actually nice because you were supposed to build a web application, and you know that everyone seems to be on the web nowadays. Like everyone seems to be building web programs nowadays. So I thought that was a useful way for me to like start learning a language. But it ended up becoming like much less, which was also a good thing because I realized it was actually more complicated than I actually thought. So I submitted like the entry for the challenge, but unfortunately I used a third party library, so well, they disqualified me. But Sao Xiong promised to give me feedback soon. Like he looked at my code and he said that when he has time, he'll give me some feedback. So, I'm looking forward to that. So basically, hold on. Yeah, so this is the image, this is the input image. These are like some of the photos of mine. So I have 1,803 photos inside this folder. And then this is what happens when you process it. So what happens in this image is that when you look really closely, there's like a lot of small little images inside. That's basically what a mosaic is. So how I go about doing this, I pick the source images, and then I resize them so that it takes less memory. And then I calculate the average color, and I create a lookup table, which is basically a struct and a lot of slices, and then I append it. I'll show the code later. And then I'll divide the input image, which is this one, into like lots of small little tiles of 16 by 16. And then I'll calculate the color distance between the tiles and the source image. All the source images. And then once I find the closest one, I'll just write the source image into a tile position. And this is the code. So let's just go really quickly. So I just set a few variables, like initialize a few variables. And then this was one of the most fun parts of the challenge, I thought, but basically of creating the program in general, because I was like, wow, I can do like a command line app. And then I just put like all the various flags, which Go magically turned into a program, and the defaults and all that. And then some error messages in case like the input file doesn't actually exist. I have to call something to let people know the output, like if there's already an image there, tell the person as well. Like some of the struct declarations I did. And this is basically the opening all the images in the pool of like source images, processing them, like calling errors in case nothing happens. Like this one's apparently, if it's a directory, you're supposed to skip it. And if it's not a JPEG file, or apparently, what I discovered is that Go is case sensitive, like most other programs would be. Like your folder, right? Everything's in uppercase. So if I only had lowercase here, it would show me, like it would just kill itself like eventually, because everything was in uppercase and I was looking for lowercase. So I had to do this. So I was playing around with some of the other entries for the competition, and some of them didn't actually handle this case very well. So I thought, I was like, yay, I did it, but some people didn't. Anyway, more opening stuff, decoding a JPEG using and if it's not JPEG, no, this is like an extra check, like, because when you decode, it sends you an image format string, I think. And then if it doesn't decode properly, it'll just print another error. And then a lot of resizing. And this is the lookup table, and I'll just append it to the lookup table. I think there's a better way.
How did you compute your color distance?
It's below in the other functions. Yeah. So this is the one where I take the input image, and then after that I opened it again, and I use I calculated the dimensions of it. And actually, this is another part where I was like, why is Go so integer? No, okay. So image width gives you an integer, which you have to compute into a float to do like math, like seeding, which you have to convert into an integer again. Yeah, I mean, I think probably can use interfaces to avoid this, but,
as a feature, they forced you to be type safe.
Yeah, so, all this type conversion, I was like, JavaScript doesn't need me to do this, but, that's how fast Go is, I guess. I mean, because I remember some other times people actually say that it's the type safety that makes some languages fast. So I guess it's a good choice. So for loop, where you just iterate along the tiles, and basically what I do is I write to a small little image, and then I calculate the distance in a way.
You control plus plus to expand the font.
Does it work?
You try.
Oh no.
Doesn't work.
Well, I could load the editor, I guess. Let's see where it is. Does it work? That's my editor. Can you see it?
Aha! Wait.
Nope, wrong one. This is the slides. Okay, let me find the editor. Okay, there it is.
Okay, it's coming.
Alright,
that's fine.
Okay, okay. So, we'll
be
right back. Where's the wrapping? Doesn't seem to work very well.
Don't worry about wood wrapping.
Okay, let's try. Where am I? Down image here. Okay, so this basically I send it to the other functions like measure color distance and which is all the way below. And then after that I do like a way to compare and find the minimum, which for some reason Go standard library didn't have it, so I had to come like Google for it and implement it on my own. But it's okay, I mean, I didn't do it before, but apparently it's quite common for a lot of people to do it, because when I was looking at the other competitors' code, they seem to have done like pretty much the same thing. So replace tiles, this is what I used to draw. I mean, like, once I figure out the tile, I'll just put it on the image itself, and then I'll draw it, and finally I'll write it, like, write the whole canvas into JPEG. So this is the way to calculate the average color. Like when you get an image, it gives you like RGBA values. And what you do is you take like every pixel of the image, I think, and then you add it all together and then you divide it by the number of pixels in the image itself. And then you send it back out. And this one is the color distance formula, which is basically supposedly a very common formula. Like, I was reading about like more complicated formulas, but you know, let's just start with the basic first, especially when I actually don't know how to build any other things. So you take the distance of each color, and then you power it, and then you add them together, and then you square root it. And this one opens each tile and decodes the file again, and then replaces it. I actually went to like look at my code again, which I'll explain later, and I removed this part because it was very, very heavy on I/O. And this one writes JPEG, and well, this is the, like, you know, you pass the flags, you check the input image, you check the output image, and well, I like knowing how long it took, and I didn't want to like run any external timers, so I just calculated the time, and then I was like, hooray, you know, your mosaic's done. In how many minutes?
Minutes.
Yeah. So this version of the code, like if you do it at default settings on a very large image, like one of my images took 88 minutes to create.
Whoa.
Yeah. Anyway, yeah, I'll explain more. Like, it's actually much faster now. Like, I actually profiled the code and took a look at. So it was the I/O that was the problem, and then I made it a lot faster. Anyway, so ghetto debugging is my best friend. Like, I don't know what else to call it, but apparently like FMP printf something is a very common way of doing things in Go. Yeah. So like basically if I didn't know what something would come out of some function somewhere, I would just put this in and just expect it to return so I can figure out how to manipulate it. But that worked for me. I'm not sure what other way is better to do it other than, you know, reading the docs and actually understanding them. But it ended up making me like design a program to do this. But I thought it was good because it means that, you know, the user actually gets some feedback when your thing is processing instead of just waiting for magic to happen. Because especially some programs, like you just type the command in and then you wait like 2 or 3 minutes for your image to appear, but you don't know if your program actually compiled successfully or if it runs successfully. So I thought like some visual feedback would be helpful. And this is ghetto profiling, which is basically like me wrapping every single, like most of the functions. That's basically how I profiled my code and figured out like where the slow parts were. Like I just put the, like I just figured out what time it was. Then I did the function and then I figured out how long it took. And then after that, I just printed it in the command line. And then after that, like I'll run my code, like I'll run my program. And yes, I learned about this, I guess it's a command. It's a program called T, which outputs your STD out, like this thing, into a file. So I did it in CSV, so that what I could do with a CSV was that. So this was what would happen. Every little thing of mine would be processed, and then I would be able to see everything like visually on a CSV, like sort it out if I had it, like had to. I don't know, I just thought it was useful. I mean, I think there's probably like Go test benchmark or something like that, but that seemed a lot more complicated to implement. So, you know, just do the simple one first. The Go challenge had a lot of entries. These are only the normal ones. I think there's like 15 entries or so. So I took a look at some of the other code, and then I just like went ahead and profiled like some of the other submissions to see. So you see, like this is the for loop, and then I just put like my profiling code in, just so that I can see where everything, like how fast everyone else took in like everything else. But it gave me an understanding of like how other programs function as well. Because what this does is that, you know, you just print according to what the program's doing. So I'll see that, you know, they take the images and analyze them, and then after that, this is like bad code, but I didn't realize that this was a struct. So you'll calculate tiles in like so and so how fast, and select tiles in like select the tile number in like so and so like nanoseconds, and then it gave me an idea. So Moses, the winner of the code, like his code is actually really excellent. Like there's interfaces everywhere and it looks really nice. But I mean, it's good to like learn from other people. Hopefully one day I'll be able to code as nice as him. Right, so this is the code I refactored. I'm not sure if I can zoom this. But it's basically like the replace tile function, like among other things. Like so what this function does is that it would open, like once I determine which image it was, it would open the file again. And that causes like IO reads, and IO reads are apparently the slowest part of my program. So what I didn't realize was that after I read everything once again, once I determined which tile it was, I would have to, well, open it again and read it again, and that caused a lot of, basically very slow. So, I mean, I didn't do this at first because I thought, wow, what happens if you read all the images in the memory, then you get like, because I think my images were like, okay, this one doesn't say, but I think they're like at least 2 gigs. So I was like, wow, like that, then you see about 2 gigs being consumed in RAM just for images that you might not even use. So, I realized that once you resize them, the images actually become much smaller. So I think the memory consumed is also much less. So profile, remove the read. So it became like 158 seconds from 88 minutes, which is about 33 times speed improvement. So that's actually how much I/O actually killed. I think if I actually use like, cause I was actually looking at my disk read speed, and it was only like reading at maybe 6 megabytes a second. And obviously an SSD can read much faster, so I have a feeling that if I use the Go channel to do all the reading like beforehand, it could probably become much, much faster. But you know, that's like stuff for another day. So yeah, that's pretty much it.
Well done.
Yeah. You can take a look at my code here, GitHub, or the short link. This one should be much easier to remember. It can be found on Twitter, and well, if you have anything, like questions or anything.
Did you use any external libraries?
Yeah, I did. I used a resized library because I didn't realize...
The reason is for using the...
Did they restrict it to standard libraries?
Yes, they did.
But you used an external?
Yeah, because I was like, have to ship it in somehow. So I was like, never mind, I just use this first.
So what does the library do?
It just resizes. It just sends your stuff into resizing. Where is my code? So NFMT resize is basically a resizing library where I have no idea where the resizing is.
So your resize actually is from that higher resolution output and lower.
Yeah. So I looked at other people's codes and apparently what you're supposed to do is you take blocks of 4, you calculate the average color and you use the average color and then you write it into a smaller. I mean, that's what nearest neighbor basically is. But, well, back then I didn't know. And now I do. So eventually I will take the time to implement that.
You of course is Mosey.
Mosey?
Yeah,
I profiled it and I think it was also about like 150 to 200 seconds. So it's comparable to my improved version of the code.
So if you start over from scratch, what do you do different?
I don't know. Like, I don't know how poorly written my code is. I mean, I guess I could abstract it more into interfaces, use like Go routines. It's just, and probably like, you know, encapsulate them more into like smaller functions. But, you know, have to ship something that works first, and then after that, you refactor it.
I think your journey is quite illustrative. You were saying you could find a minimum function or something like that.
Yeah. There's no math.min, I think.
Oh, math.min?
Yeah.
You hit the very famous Go no generics problem.
Oh, okay.
It's very controversial. Some people want generics, some people don't.
Yeah, so I was hunting around the math library, like the documentation, like, why is there no min? Isn't there like a basic thing that you're supposed to have? And then it's not there, so, you know, you have to just key in, like, do it yourself. Yeah.
So how long did the whole
thing take? I calculated the time I first wrote the code and I think it was about 2.5 weeks. Yeah. So yeah. And then after that when I refactored the code, I think it took me only about 2 hours. I was like, you know, profile, I see the I.O. and then after that, hey, just remove the I.O. call and you know, it becomes faster. But I guess this isn't the hard part about writing code. It's probably like writing good code is probably harder. Yeah.
I like your profiling method. It's very simple and easy to understand. But I think it's worthwhile if you do a lot of profiling to learn the profile functions within Go itself.
Yeah, as in I know that Go test has this benchmark function which I'm supposed to use, but well.
Well, you can also determine how much memory each function uses.
Be careful there, though, because there's a look. The Go dirty secrets. There is no debugger. I mean, there is one on web, but yeah. It's not very convincing.
Yeah.
The other dirty little secret is yes, there is pprof, the quote unquote default profile. It doesn't work in Go. It just plain doesn't work.
Does it work in what?
Doesn't work in Mac.
Oh,
it returns bad data. So the way we use pprof, but the only way I can do it is upload it to a Unix box, run the pprof, pull the files down, and then start querying. It's a very good tool, and I recommend it. But it's horribly annoying, and it doesn't work in the box. You like the Mac.
Oh. I never hit that problem because I run Ubuntu.
I'm considering Joomla in my Mac. just for that particular thing, because the tool is really good.
Yeah.
It's just an irritating.
1.3. Docker.
Mm-hmm. 1.3?
I don't know, I haven't joked.
Go 1.4, change the garbage collector, wrote some code.
I've read people say that running the pcroff in a virtualized environment is also a bit dodgy, like it doesn't necessarily give you true values. I can't speak whether that's accurate or not, personally. And frankly, I uploaded to AWS, which is by default a virtualized environment,
yep.
Yet it somehow works. So, you know, good luck, I guess is my tomorrow in this way.
Any questions or any feedback? Please take a look at my GitHub profile and give me a code review if you can, so that I can, you know. Oh, yeah.
Yep. So thank you, Valentine, and thank you everyone for coming. Thanks to the Grab Taxi guys who sponsored today's venue. Still looking for speakers. If there are any speakers, please let us know. Thanks.